associated with bloodshed. What had happened precisely in Naxalwadi incident? So Mao was basically trying to assert an idea that the only way the poor people, exploited and suppressed people in India will ever get justice is through violence. And let's not forget one thing, sir. In the beginning when we said that Mao in China did a revolution, he did a revolution by uniting the farmers and the poor. And that revolution, if you study the Chinese revolution or the Maoist revolution, was a very violent revolution in China. And that is what something that he started observing, that this could be a possibility in India in the future. When Mao appreciated what happened in Naxalwadi, Charu Majumdar also was the happiest man in the country at that time, because he was of the opinion that if Mao has appreciated what has happened in Naxalwadi, then it means that what happened there is absolutely right. And Charu Majumdar now was completely of this opinion that the only further strategy now should be to replicate this Naxalwadi type violent activity elsewhere in the country. Charu Majumdar was now very clearly of this opinion that the further strategy now should be to replicate this Naxalwadi type activity in the other areas of Bengal, Bihar and Odisha. And that's the only way by which the poor can get justice now. But you see, one very important thing here is that even when this Naxalwadi incident happened, and even when Mao appreciated this and all that, the people in the country basically blamed CPIM for Naxalwadi. People in the country began to say ki after all the Naxalwadi incident was done by members of the CPIM. The entire party now was very critically viewed by the people in the country. There was a lot of debate and discussion that happened in the media also at that time, that CPIM is basically a violent party whose members did Naxalwadi incident. But the fact of the matter is, the question that we need to ask is, did CPIM officially ever advocate for violence? They never did that. Did CPIM officially ever advocated a violent Kisan Sabha? They never officially did that. One member of the CPIM, Charu Majumdar, his own interpretation, different from the organization's interpretation, led to violent activity. And because of that, the entire organization was being blamed apparently. That is why you see, after the Naxalwadi incident, even though when the people of the country were blaming CPIM, at a time when the CPIM officially never preached violence, the party decided to clarify. They decided to offer clarification for their position. In December 1967, the CPIM organized a meeting in Madurai where they invited everybody, all of their members, including Charu Majumdar and his followers. The idea of the meeting was to use the meeting as a platform to offer clarification about the fact that the party does not stand for violence. The idea was to use the meeting as a platform to tell everybody that the party officially has no such strategy of violence. Now you see, when the meeting began, Charu and his followers were sitting at one side, the rest of the CPIM people sat separately from them. When the meeting began, the people of the CPIM surprisingly now began to criticize Charu and his followers. And very harsh and heavy type of criticism was leveled upon Charu and his followers. Firstly, CPIM members began to say, ki Charu, you and your followers are nothing but a bunch of frustrated individuals. You know, saying something like this in the form of a critical assessment within a political organization itself is a very big thing, firstly. And this particular type of criticism is leveled upon Charu and his followers. CPIM members said, ki Charu, you and your followers are basically frustrated people. Now, despite this criticism being leveled upon Charu at that time, within the party, he kept quiet. He did not respond. This further angered the members of the CPIM, who resorted to more harsher criticism now. They began to say, ki Charu, you and your followers basically suffer from some kind of ideological disease of violence that you are spreading. Ideological disease of violence. ये जो कम्युनिस्ट होते हैं ना, लेफ्टिस्ट जो होते हैं, ये इनकी अंग्रेजी बड़ी अच्छी होती है और अच्छी भी कुछ नहीं होती इनको, वो अंग्रेजी के 10-20 शब्दों का रट्टा लगा होता है, बस उसी पे खेलते हैं जीवन भर, बाकी दिमाग में तो पूरा खाली होता है लेफ्टिस्ट का और इक्वली राइटिस्ट का भी, राइटिस्ट में तो गोबर भरी होती है। सो वन थिंग इज वेरी क्लियर दैट यू सी व्हेन दिस काइंड ऑफ हार्शर क्रिटिसिज्म वाज आल्सो लेवल्ड अपॉन Charu, despite being a Bengali again, he kept quiet. He did not respond. And as he did not respond, this further angered the CPIM members. Now they began to say, Charu, you and your followers should be handed over to the police for what you people preached in Siliguri Kisan Sabha, etc. PCR bulao inko yahan se uthao. Aisi baat nahi hai. Now, sir, one thing became very clear. That primarily when this kind of criticism was leveled, it is at this moment that Charu decided to counter criticize these people. He stood up, he decided to counter criticize, but in a very intellectual fashion. Charu basically told these people that you people of CPIM are basically parliamentarians. He just said this and he sat down. His counter criticism was that you people of CPIM are nothing but parliamentarians. समझने वाले समझ गए क्या criticism था, जिनको नहीं समझ आया वो कह रहे थे कुछ आओ पागल हो गया यहाँ इतने भारी शब्दों का प्रयोग हो रहा है, ये कैसे शब्द बोल रहा है। अब सर द क्वेश्चन इज दैट यू नो इट वॉज अ वेरी डीप लेवल ऑफ क्रिटिसिज्म दैट चारू इन रिसर्च, बट द क्वेश्चन इज दैट व्हेन ही सेड दैट यू नो यू पीपल आर पार्लियामेंटेरियंस, the question is that what was the intention of Charu at that time which he wanted to communicate to these members of the CPIM here? Aap bata bhai kya ye ek shabd bol raha hai ye ki pagal hai kya ye? Tu bata bhai, ha tum to jude ho na log. Representative of people, ये क्या मतलब हो? अब इन्हें तुम्हें definition लिखवाई है तो रट के बता रहे हैं मेरे को। हाँ तुम बता भाई, क्या मतलब होगा इसका? चलो one thing which our friend says is very right. What Charu meant by saying that you people are parliamentarians is that he was trying to communicate an idea to these people. That the members of the CPIM have forgotten the fact that why the party was formed. His intention was to tell them in one word that the party was formed for the welfare of the poor people. But what he communicated to these people here is that instead of trying to work for the welfare of the poor people, the members of the CPIM are only interested to basically grab power to enter into the parliament. By using this word, his intention was to tell these members of the CPIM that you people are only power seekers. You want to seek power, grab power with an intention to enter into the parliament, enjoy the privileges of being a member of the parliament and not work for the welfare of the poor. When the Madurai meeting ended in 1967 December, Charu understood one thing, that my idea is to replicate a Naxalbari type violence activity, which I feel is the only solution today. The CPIM as a party is not willing to accept that. So there is no point being a part of this organization anymore. After the Madurai meeting came to an end, in January 1968, Charu along with his followers quit CPIM and they established a temporary committee by the name of AICCCR. So please write down the full form. All India Coordinated Committee, All India Coordinated Committee of Communist Revolutionaries, All India Coordinated Committee of Communist Revolutionaries. So you see, Charu has now quit the organization of CPI, he is no more a part of that. He has established a temporary committee of communist revolutionaries. Now these people start discussing. The discussion is how do we replicate Naxalwadi type violent activity elsewhere in the country. As the discussion happens, consensus over two points emerges. The consensus over the first point is that to replicate Naxalwadi type activities in the country, we basically require a mass base. Unless or until we do not have a mass base with us, we cannot replicate violence. Let us not forget one thing. Naxalwadi activity also happened with 100 plus members of the CPIM. Participation of masses was critical there. So they were of the opinion that first thing that we require is a mass base. Second thing is that the mass base has to be mobilized through a political party. So we require a political party. And unless or until we don't have a political party, we will not be able to mobilize the mass base. So with the consensus achieved on these two points, finally, as the time progressed, on 22nd April 1969, a new political party was floated called CPI-ML, that is Communist Party of India Marxist-Leninist. This Communist Party of India Marxist-Leninist is created in 1969. The founder of this party is Charu Majumdar. The creation of Communist Party of India Marxist-Leninist officially marks the beginning of the first phase of left-wing extremism in India. As we are in the third phase today, the first phase began officially with the formation of the Communist Party of India Marxist-Leninist. The party now decided to widen the mass base through certain strategies that they adopted. Now let us have a look at the strategies of the party which they used to widen the mass base. अभी ये पार्टी इसने ये 22 अप्रैल को क्यों बनाई है, 23 को बना लेता, 23 को होली थी है, बढ़िया एकदम गुलाल लगा के गुजिया खा के पार्टी मनाते, और 23 को संडे था, आराम से सुबह सो के उठ के पार्टी मनाते, शनि भारी पड़ गया इन पे, क्या रीजन होगा क्या वो था बता तेरे को, तुम तो जुड़े हो इनके साथ, तुमने काम किया वहां पे छत्तीसगढ़ में, जंगलों में घूमता है तू वहां लाल झंडा लेके, हाँ तुम बता भाई होली वाले दिन अटैक प्लान किया होगा ये लश्कर के लड़के ऐसी बातें कर रहे हैं भाई, हाँ ये बताएगा ये, हाँ तुम बता भाई तू राजनीति विज्ञान पढ़ता है, ये राजनीति विज्ञान वाले लड़कों को पता होगा और किसी को नहीं पता होगा ये, हाँ बिल्कुल गलत बेटा, तू मेरे को ज्योग्राफी ऑप्शनल का लड़का लग रहा है, ऐसी बात करी है तूने, मार्क्स का नहीं था बट ही ट्राइड वेल, इट वाज द बर्थडे ऑफ लेनिन, टू कमेमोरेट द बर्थडे ऑफ लेनिन दैट डे द सीपीआई मार्क्सिस्ट लेनिनिस्ट वाज क्रिएटेड. ट्राई टू रिकलेक्ट सर, इन द बिगिनिंग वी सेड वन वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग, लेनिन इंट्रोड्यूस्ड द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ अ पॉलिटिकल पार्टी which was not talked about by Marx, which is what he tried to do by creating a political party, which was the consensus in the committee also. CPI-ML now adopted certain strategies. Let us look at the strategies now. Build ties with China. Carry out an armed struggle. Resort to propaganda and a disinformation campaign. You see, this is a four-point strategy. Building ties with China is very crucial because let's not forget, Mao had appreciated the Naxalwadi incident. So they thought that, you know, building relation with China is very crucial. Propaganda, armed struggle, disinformation campaign. How do these 3 points get implemented? It is basically through 3 points here. Number one, party decided to carry out annihilation of class enemies. You see, right now we are in the first phase. In the first phase, the first strategy of the party is to carry out annihilation of the class enemies. As we will go to the second and the third phase, the strategies will always remain the same. This is a very crucial factor about the extremists here, which signifies that there is a continuity in the operational strategy. Number two, they are going to identify certain class enemies right now. As they are going to progress in the second and the third phase, the list of the class enemies will only increase, and the old class enemies will always be there. Two things are important to note here. The word that they are using is called annihilation. Annihilation basically means a very brutal form of killing. You see very clearly, sir, they are not saying killing of class enemies. Deliberately, they are basically using a word which will have a deeper psychological effect called annihilation. Means a brutal way of killing, number one. Number two, party says annihilation of class enemies. They say that there are some enemies in the society who are enemies of the poor class. They have to be brutally killed. Right now, the number of class enemies to begin with in the first phase will be limited. As the movement progresses in the subsequent phases, the class enemies get violent. First class enemy here is what he will tell. Bata tu kon hoga? Zamindar number one. So first is the zamindar. Aa tu bata bhi agla. Police. Theek hai. Tere ko milega dekhi Andhra khadar. Uthai le jayin tere ko. आप बता भाई कौन होगा अगला? हाँ तू बता भाई पीछे तुम जो लाल कपड़े पहन के आ तुम कम्युनिस्ट कैपिटलिस्ट कौन से इंडस्ट्रियल क्लास इंडस्ट्री कहाँ है इंडिया में अभी भी रो रहा है वो मेक इन इंडिया मेक इन इंडिया मेक इन इंडिया 5 साल हो गए भाई साहब कान सूख गए हमारे सुन सुन मेक इन इंडिया के नाम पे भाई साहब लिच्छत पापड़ बन रहा हाँ बेटा तू बता रहे क्लास एनिमी का नहीं भाई उन्होंने क्या कहा अब तो तुमने पार्टी अपनी मना ली यार ऑपोजिशन वालों को क्या करना है तुम्हें लग रहा है चारों मजुमदार कोई अमित शाह ऐसी बातें कर रहा है ऑपोजिशन के एमएलए थोड़ी उठाने तुम हाँ बेटा तू बता दे इंस्पिरेशन ने हमारे दोस्त ने एक आइडिया दिया उसने कहा कैपिटलिस्ट सोच थोड़ा और आगे अगर तेरे को कुछ समझ आता है तो वेरी गुड वेरी राइट मनी लेंडर्स अभी तू अगला पॉलिटिकल क्लास तो ये क्या मतलब एनजीओ अरे पॉलिटिकल क्लास क्यों है यार जब आपने अपनी पार्टी बना रखी है कैसी बातें कर रहा है यार हाँ भाई तू बता नहीं पता होगा तेरे को एक बचा और बता दे आ तू बता भाई उन्होंने क्या बिगाड़ा तेरा उनको तो कोटा मिल गया अपर कास्ट वालों को हाँ भाई तू भी है 10% में मालूम है तेरे को क्या पता तू ही हो बता दे एक बचा बस 4 क्लास है टोटल स्टार्टिंग में बिल्कुल सही कहा मैडम आपने रेवेन्यू ऑफिशियल ऑल दी लैंड रेवेन्यू ऑफिशियल्स हु वर हैंड्स इन ग्लव्स विद दी जमींदार्स in doing that manipulation of the land records and assisting the deprivation of the poor in the society at that time. First thing is that the annihilation of these people is going to happen. Second thing is that how will the annihilation happen? The party said, through the use of conventional weapons. There shall be the usage of the conventional weaponry for the purpose of carrying out this annihilation activity. And the first weapon that they will use is what? Evil death. Now we do that. You can hear that. क्या वेपन यूज करेंगे? लाठी. चलो बिल्कुल वही सही बोला इसने. टाइम टेस्टेड वेपन है. नक्सलवाली में रिजल्ट मिला है. एम्पिरिकली वेरीफाइड. लाठी इज गोइंग टू बी द फर्स्ट वन नो डाउट. हाँ भी बेटा तू बता अगला. वाओ कहाँ से आएंगे वो उनके पास? कैरोसिन में भरते रहो तो मतलब वो यूपी से है? बता दे कहाँ से? मेरठ से है ना? है ना मेरठ? उसके आसपास का ही होगा. वहीं बना के ऐसी बात कहाँ से आने ऐसी बातें करते हैं कमाल. हाँ भाई तू बता बेटा. वाह क्या ना तीर कमाल. अरे अपने देश के लोग इतना पिछड़ा क्यों सोच रहे हैं? पांच साल के नहीं है वहां सिंध में रहने वाले लोग नहीं है ये अपने हैं देश के. बिल्कुल सही कहा मैडम आपने. सिकल इज अ पार्ट ऑफ द कम्युनिस्ट फ्लैग ऑल्सो. If you ever observe the communist flag very carefully, you will observe one thing, that sickle is a part of the symbol that they use there, which officially they somehow advocate that it is used for the purpose of, you know, signifying the blood and sweat of the farmer, but anyway it is not, it is used for basically killing people. So that is the first thing here. Tu bata bhi agla. Wo kahan se aayenge abhi? कन्वेंशनल वेपन है तू बता भी बेटा. एक्स इफेक्ट. सही कह रहा है. जहां कोई पुलिस वाला मिल जाए एक्स लगा. ठीक है कुछ तो गलत नहीं है. तू बता भी अगर तू बता दे बिल्कुल बाई गॉड बिजनेस क्लास बैठा है एक्स्ट्रा लेग रूम. ये देखो बेचारे इकोनॉमी ये स्लीपर. एक वेपन बता रहे बेटा कोई भी देसी कट्टा. भाई ये तेरा मेरे से उम्मीद ही नहीं थी यार ऐसी. अभी तू बता बेटा नहीं पता है बेटा जीवन में कब क्या जरूरत पड़ जाए किस चीज की. आज ही याद कर ले बार बार जीवन में कॉपी नहीं खोलनी. कल को ज्वाइन करना पड़ जाए इनको वहां पे इंटरव्यू में पूछेंगे तेरे से. बताओ अवेयरनेस होनी चाहिए. हाँ तू बता बेटा वहां पे. हाँ नाइफ. ये नेपाल की तेरे को वो मूर्खा लग रही है. नाइफ कहाँ से आ गई? हाँ डॉक्टर साहब आप बताओ. डॉक्टर रेड्डी सर. यार कैसी बात कर रहा है. ये प्रॉब्लम पंजाब में चलती है. शॉट कहाँ से आ रही? बंगाल बिहार उड़ीसा. ऐसा वेपन कहां से यूज होगा यार वहां पे? है वेरी राइट हैमर. वेरी गुड. ऐसे उपाय रखे हो देखो बहुत ताले तोड़े जी को. जी आप बताओ जी उधर पीछे भाई रोड इनका पंजाब से हमारे आप बताओ आपको कप्तान साहब की कसम जी चलो व्हाट ही सेज इन्होंने बिल्कुल देसी शब्द यूज करा है जो पंजाब में भी यूज नहीं करते स्पेड वेरी राइट हाँ तू बता बेटे वो मतलब क्या कुछ वो फ्रेंच वर्ड बोल रहा था हाँ भाई तू बता उधर जैवलिन वेरी गुड वेरी वेरी राइट यू सी इफ यू ऑब्जर्व वन थिंग वेरी केयरफुली You will understand that most of the conventional weaponry that the party has deliberately selected at this moment, number one, is in the form of agricultural equipment, which is such equipment in the form of things which are readily available with the farmer or the poor people who are going to be the mouthpiece of the party. Third thing is that if using these weapons, you have to carry out the annihilation. How will the annihilation be carried out? It will be carried out through the strategy of guerrilla warfare. Now let us try to understand what is guerrilla warfare. How did they try to use guerrilla warfare? Understand the strategy of guerrilla warfare very carefully because this strategy remains the strategy of the party till today. And it is very crucial in the overall extremist movement. Charu says firstly that there will be creation of number one, a unit of 7+1 people, where 7 people are going to be led by 1 unit commander. So 7+1 is equal to 8, where 1 is the unit commander. The unit will identify a class enemy. Let us say the unit identified a class enemy called Zamindar in a village whose annihilation they wish to carry out. After the unit identifies a class enemy, they will now prepare an activity map. Activity map means that they will observe the class enemy to identify the best place to undertake the annihilation. You undertake the observation of the class enemy. Observe its daily based activities so that you are able to identify the best place to carry out the annihilation. Let's assume for a moment that they identified that whenever the zamindar goes from point A to point B on the road, this is the best place to do the annihilation. Whenever he travels from point A to point B on the road, we are just assuming that this could be the best place they have identified through the activity map to carry out the annihilation. Charu says that now the unit itself will fix a day of annihilation. On that day of annihilation, the people of the unit will stand on both sides of the road waiting for the class enemy to come with the conventional weaponry in their hand. They will just wait for the class enemy to come on that day. You see, two important things are to be kept in mind here. If you have observed these steps very carefully, one inference you can very clearly make is that in this regard, the strategy of the party is a very highly decentralized strategy. It is the unit that decides the class enemy. It is the unit that identifies the day to kill him, the place to kill him. The central high command of the party has no role to play. When we will talk about the government strategy to tackle this problem in the next class, we will see that this is the first weakness of the government strategy. The weakness is that we are unable to reach out, number one, at this micro level, where the party adopts a highly decentralized approach. Number two, see the beauty here. Charu says, give me these people of the unit will stand on both sides of the road waiting for the class enemy to come with conventional weapons in their hand. In a village, it is not a very disturbing sight to see 7-8 people standing on two sides of the road waiting with certain agricultural equipments in their hand. Because it will not create a suspicion in the mind of anybody as to why they are there. But the beauty is that these 7-8 people know the reason for they being waiting there. This is how they conceal themselves. That is why when we will talk about the government strategy again, we will see that the beauty is that they are able to conceal themselves so beautifully that government finds it very difficult to identify who is a Naxalite and who is not. Now Now, second thing here is, as they are waiting for the class enemy to come, let us say the zamindar comes, the unit carries out the annihilation they came in. Charu says that the moment the zamindar is killed, the unit, the people of the unit here, 8 people, they should immediately rush and hide in the jungle. After killing the class enemy, immediately hide in the jungle nearby. You see, this is a very important thing, sir. Any extremist organization will resort to guerrilla warfare, specifically at a place where they know that there is a geographical advantage. And geographical advantage is either in the form of a forested area, or a geographical advantage is in the form of a hilly terrain. That is why you see, in the northeastern states, the northeast insurgent groups will resort to guerrilla warfare. Because northeastern states have a geographical advantage of a hilly terrain. Left-wing extremists will resort to guerrilla warfare because the place where the problem exists today, the Chhattisgarh area and all that, is the place where there is a forested area. Guerrilla warfare gets practiced in a very important way in such kind of geographically advantageous areas. Now, Charu says, merely killing the class enemy here was not our only goal. Actual game begins after the class enemy is killed. Because Charu says, after the class enemy is killed, the society is charged. After the class enemy is killed, the society is charged. And we have to take advantage of this charged society. Charu says, let's assume for a moment that there is a zamindar in a village. That zamindar in the village is killed. After he is killed, people in the village will start talking about it. Normally, people will talk about such an incident wherever they can gather. Where they can gather includes places like a tea stall, or probably a bus stop or a railway station or anybody's house, etc. Charu says that when people in the society are talking about this, that is the time period when a member of the intellectual wing of the party will basically go out. And that is the time period when the member of the intellectual wing of the party will carry out these two things: propaganda and disinformation campaign. Well, let's assume that the zamindar is killed. Let's say there is a tea stall. And let's say in the tea stall there are 3 or 4 people while having tea, they are talking about this incident. One person tells the other person that, you know, somebody killed the zamindar yesterday. Other person says, it is good, somebody killed him, he used to exploit all the people in the village. Charu says that when these people are discussing, that is the time period when a member of the intellectual wing of the party will approach them. He will go to the tea stall. And when he will approach these people there, he will tell them there, ki my friend, anyone who exploits the poor will be killed like this. Anyone who suppresses the poor will be killed like this. The moment an intellectual member of the party says something like that, these 3-4 people will suddenly ask him, ki who are you? How can you say this? That is the time period, Charu says, that this member of the intellectual wing of the party will say, ki the reason why I say this is because of CPIML. CPIML is the party that will fight for the poor. CPIML is the party that will ensure justice to the poor. And CPIML is a party that will ensure that anybody who suppresses the poor will be killed. You see, what is this member of the intellectual wing of the party trying to do? Literally, he is trying to undertake propaganda. He is trying to propagate the ideology of the party. And Charu says that while the propaganda is going on, it has to be coupled with a disinformation campaign. A disinformation campaign is a campaign amongst the people against the state. It is a campaign amongst the people against the state, sir. Very important. That you will, while doing the propaganda, tell these people, ki my friend, don't forget the fact that the police is your enemy. Because when the zamindar had suppressed you, when you went to the police, to complain. The police did not listen to you. They are your enemy. Don't forget the fact, my friend, that that land revenue officer, that patwari, that SDM, the DM, they are also your enemies. Because they were hands in glove with these zamindars to deprive you of the land that was promised to you. So you are carrying out a disinformation campaign, a campaign amongst the people against the state. Because the people of the state, primarily the police and the land revenue officials, are a part of your class enemy. So you are inciting the people to attack them. And Charuk said ki once we adopt this strategy, we will be able to widen the mass base of the party. And they were able to do this. And as they were able to do this, finally, it was in May 1969 that the party decided to replicate Naxalbari type violent activity from a place called Srikakulam, which is a place in Andhra Pradesh. This question has come in the exam related to Srikakulam. Please write down the question. Despite having no historical trace of violence, why is Srikakulam known as the birthplace of extremism in India? Birthplace of extremism in India. You see, the question is very straightforward and simple. Now understand one thing very clearly, sir. If you try to study the history of this place called Srikakulam, you will observe one thing. That the last time when violence ever happened in Srikakulam, surprisingly, was during the Ashoka's Kalinga battle. It was in the ancient times, during the Kalinga battle of Ashoka, that this place ever witnessed violence which was historically recorded. Since then till today, today means right now, May 1969, this place never witnessed violence. But paradoxically, this is the same place today we say, which is the birthplace of the extremism in India. The question is how and why. Two reasons are. First reason is, people who are living in Srikakulam are called Girijans. The Girijans are basically poor tribal people. They constitute 90% of the population of Srikakulam. And ironically, these 90% people, the tribal people called Girijans, have been exploited by the 10% zamindars. So first thing is that there is exploitation present in this place called Srikakulam, which itself makes it conducive for any violent activity because of suppression of a community. Second important factor here is that Srikakulam, basically, geographically speaking, is a hilly terrain. It is a hilly terrain. A hilly terrain is an ideal condition for guerrilla warfare. Now, one thing to remember here is that, you know, in early 1950s, there was a person in Srikakulam by the name of V. Satyanarayan. V. Satyanarayan was basically a school teacher. And he was very upset seeing the suppression of the Girijan community. At one fine day in early 1950s, he decided to resign his job as a school teacher. And he decided to work for the welfare of the Girijan community. He tirelessly worked for their welfare. By 1960s, Satyanarayan was now one of the most popular persons amongst the Girijan community. Even though Satyanarayan himself was not a Girijan, he was not one of those tribals. But he became one of the very popular persons amongst the community because of the welfare that he did. Satyanarayan also saw what happened in 1967 in Naxalwari. And as Satyanarayan saw what happened in Naxalwari, he was very inspired by what happened in Naxalwari. That incident of Naxalwari 1967. And when he found out that the brain behind this Naxalwari incident was a person called Charu Majumdar, after this Naxalwari incident, he contacted Charu Majumdar, started having regular meetings with him. And over a period of time, it was finally in May 1969, after the meetings between Charu Majumdar and Satyanarayan came to an end, that the decision was number one taken that Naxalwari type violent activity will be replicated from Srikakulam. Let's not forget one thing. Sometime back only we mentioned the CPI ML was created in 1969 on 22nd April. After the creation of CPI ML, it was the decision of the CPI ML between Charu and Satyanarayan from May 1969 to replicate Naxalwari type violence from Srikakulam. If violence officially came to Srikakulam, the violence came to Srikakulam by CPI ML after the decision of the party collectively between these two people. So you can write down few lines here. Srikakulam witnessed historical suppression of the dominant tribal community, called Girijans. Over a period of time, a person by the name of V. Satyanarayan dedicated his life for the welfare of the Girijan community. He emerged as one of the very popular leaders amongst Girijans. Satyanarayan was very deeply inspired by the Naxalwari incident, which compelled him to undertake meetings with Charu Majumdar in May 1969. A collective decision was taken to replicate Naxalwari type violent activity, in Srikakulam. Satyanarayan was made the leader. And violence was introduced under a program codenamed as the Immediate Program, codenamed as the Immediate Program. a four-point strategy was adopted. Number one, build armed revolutionary bases. Build armed revolutionary bases. Number two, carry out an armed struggle. Carry out an armed struggle. Number three, offer resistance to the police forces. Number four, seize the property from the landlords. Seize the property from the landlords. From next line onwards, you can write down. As the program began in May 1969, as the program began in May 1969, there was immediate police suppression. Which continued parallelly. ये देखो, अंधेरा हो गया भाई साहब, भूत भूत आएंगे. Which continued parallelly, and it was in December 1969 that in one of the police encounters, Satyanarayan was killed. In one of the police encounters, Satyanarayan was killed, and the movement abruptly came to an end in Srikakulam. The members of the CPIML were demotivated because of the police suppression. And as a result of which, it could affect future operations of the party. In order to motivate the members of the CPIML, Charu decided to initiate cultural revolution. Now you see, there are few things to be kept in mind here. First thing is that, you know, the movement in Srikakulam began in May 1969. But by December 1969, the movement came to an end because Satyanarayan got killed in the encounter. After that, the party members obviously were very demotivated because the movement was a very short-lived movement in Andhra. So you see, no doubt the party members were demotivated. But you know, Charu tried to give a very different logic to these party members. He told the people of the CPIML that what Srikakulam as an incident has taught us is that anywhere in the rural areas in our country, if we have an exploited mass base like these Girijans, we can instantly replicate violence. You see, fact of the matter is they have been suppressed here. Charu agrees that we have been suppressed here. But he says ki even if we have been suppressed by the police, let us look at the incident differently. What the incident has basically taught us is that anywhere in the country, if we have an exploited mass base like the Girijans, replicating violent activity there will not be difficult, number one. But because Charu understood that the party members are demotivated right now, to boost their motivation, he decided to go for cultural revolution. Cultural revolution was initiated by Charu in January 1970. Cultural revolution was a program to take the ideology of the party to the urban areas. Cultural revolution was basically an ideology or a movement to take the entire thinking to the urban areas. Charu Majumdar is of the opinion right now that as we have been suppressed in the rural areas, party members are right now demotivated. So thereby, let us go to the urban areas, which will be a new theater to work upon, which will basically offer the party members a different place to work upon, which will help in boosting up their motivation. Under the Cultural Revolution, CPIML decided to go to urban areas. In the urban areas, in the Cultural Revolution, they did three things. Number one, they reached out to the urban workers. Charu told the urban workers that whatever work you are doing in any way is not helping the poor people. And thereby, as whatever work you are doing is not helping the poor people, you should leave that work, join CPIML, and work for the welfare of the poor people. So his first focus in the urban areas was to basically get people from the urban working community. Something that even Lenin had advocated, the channelization of the energies of the urban workers through a political party, is what he was trying here. Secondly, he spoke to urban students in various colleges and universities also in the urban areas. He told these urban students that all that your college or university is trying to teach you is on how to pass an exam, and they are not trying to teach you on anything on how to work for the welfare of the poor. देखो चारू इसमें कुछ गलत नहीं कह रहा कि भाई the only thing that your college or university is trying to teach you is on how to pass an exam. They are not trying to teach you on anything on how to work for the welfare of the poor community. So he told the urban students there in the colleges and universities to leave your college, university and join CPIML. Now this idea resonated very well amongst the student community. College mein waise kaun padhne jata hai? So student community found it very appealing. Many of them began to romanticize this idea. And the third thing that he did under Cultural Revolution was basically idol smashing campaign. One of the very crucial things here. Charu said ki there are some people in our society whose idols we have created. Murtiyan bana rakhi hain. These people in the society do not deserve these idols. Wherever we find the idols of these people, we have to smash them and break them. Idol smashing campaign, murti tod campaign. So people got very excited. Charu kiski murti todni chalti bata. So he said there are a lot of people to begin with. इसने कहा ये चाचा ही तोड़ो पहले चाचा ही मूर्तियां टूटी फिर चाचा ही के बाद इसने कहा कि ये इसको बाबू को भी पकड़ लो बाबू की मूर्तियां टूटी अब सर वन ऑफ द प्रॉब्लम हियर वाज कि दिस आइडल स्मैशिंग कैंपेन we can understand very clearly is because of the fact that these people who are being the targets of this campaign are proponents of non-violence. And Charu's ideology on the other parallel is pure violence. It was imminent for him to target these people, number one. Number two, even though when he tried to do all these three things under Cultural Revolution, ironically the Cultural Revolution overall was basically a failure. And it did not generate the required appeal in the urban community. Now, one reason why the Cultural Revolution was basically a failure is because the alternative that Charu was providing to the people to join CPI-ML was a very weak alternative. Because you see, when you are telling the urban workers to leave their jobs and join CPI-ML to work for the welfare of the poor, that seems to be good. But the question is, did the CPI-ML itself did any good work for the welfare of poor till now? What was the past of CPI-ML? You did extremism and violence in Srikakulam, and you were suppressed by the police there. People in the urban areas know you through your past. Your past is that you did violence and you were suppressed. You never did anything as a role model for the welfare of the poor. Aapne koi Gujarat model nahi banaya tha maa. So when you never had a past, which anyway never existed for even Gujarat, but the thing is that because the alternative anyway was very poor, it did not resonate as an idea amongst the urban community. But you see, the government was very concerned. Because the government realized that now these people have come to the urban areas as well. And therefore the government decided to tackle that. Sometime in June 1970, government responded by launching an operation by the codename of Operation Steeplechase. So sometime in June 1970, the government decided to launch an operation by the codename called Operation Steeplechase. This operation was a joint operation of the central government and the state government. Center and the states worked together. States, specifically the ones where this problem was there. Massively of which Bengal, Bihar and Odisha were the top priority states. When this operation was launched, it lasted for a very long period of time, starting from June 1970 almost till April 1972. So it lasted almost nearly for 2 years. But ironically, even if this operation lasted for almost 2 years, the operation somehow failed to arrest the senior leaders of the party like Charu. Operation failed to kill any senior leaders of the party and other people who were basically the brain behind all this extremism. All that the operation succeeded was basically in picking up small level people of the party who never had any idea about what the objectives of the party are, and probably were people who only participated in one or the other Kisan Sabha one point of time in their life. It is not wrong to say, in short, that this massively planned operation for such a long time also ended up in being a failure. And what is very surprising is that the operation failed only because of one reason. And the reason was that the government itself undertook wide publicity of the operation before its launch. And as there was massive publicity by the government of this operation before its launch, the operation basically failed. But somehow there was one success that the operation certainly achieved. The success that the operation achieved was that it was able to instill fear in the minds of the members of the CPI-ML, who were now very deeply concerned about the fact of a massive operation of the government like this. That is why after the operation was called off in April 1972, within the party, people now became very critical of this person, Charu Majumdar. People within the party told Charu Majumdar, ki Charu, today we are all safe because the government basically publicized this operation which was their mistake. Tomorrow if a government launches a similar operation like this, of this magnitude, without publicizing it, the party will have no future because all of us are going to be crushed immediately. Which was also the truth what they were saying. They were basically trying to blame Charu for all this. But Charu became very critical. He said ki anyone who raises any question in the party right now, I will expel them from the party. People said ki Charu, please understand one thing, there are few mistakes we have made, we need to rectify them. People said ki Charu, the first mistake is that today we are fighting an armed Indian state. And when we are fighting an armed Indian state, we can't fight with conventional weapons. We need modern weapons. Please understand that. But Charu again said, anyone who raises any question in the party, I will expel them from the party. People are saying we are talking about the betterment of the party. Instead of you accepting, why are you threatening us? Then some people in the party at that time even raised some questions. They said, Charu, don't you think that we did whatever we did without any adequate planning? Firstly, we did a movement in Srikakulam, where we were suppressed by the police. Rather than trying to strengthen our presence in the rural areas, next month you said in January, let's go to the urban areas. And when we went to the urban areas, we were not able to create an appeal amongst the urban community because there was no planning in the urban areas. Again, he threatened them with expulsion. Now these party members, they got very frustrated. All these party members came together and they expelled Charu from the party. May 1972. Charu is himself expelled from the party by his party members. This is a very awkward situation. When Charu is expelled from the party, the government was observing all this. The government was keeping a very close watch upon these incidents within the party. Government realized that Charu has been expelled. Government saw that, you know, there is a problem and Charu is now very upset because he has been expelled. Government launched a massive manhunt. And in June 1972, the police arrested Charu. Even if the police arrested Charu in June 1972, in July 1972, Charu died in the police custody. It was a custodial death within the 1 month period. As Charu died in the police custody, with the death of Charu Majumdar in the police custody in July 1972, first phase of the left-wing extremism came to an end. Because after the leader of the party was arrested and he died, the operations could not continue. The party completely fragmented. There were a lot of internal differences also. As a result of which, first phase not only came to an end, but there was a gap for some time in the extremist activity. The rest of the members who were there of the party, they also decided to leave the organization. It is believed that some of them went to Nepal. It is believed some of them resorted to normal agricultural activity, etc. So party completely broke up. But you know, again, this did not last for very long. Because in December 1972 itself, a party member by the name of Satyamurthy who was one of the friends of Charu himself, he decided to revive the organization again. In December 1972, he established an organization by the name of CPI-MLPWG, Communist Party of India, Marxist-Leninist People's War Group. आधे पेज का नाम रखा पार्टी का भाई ने. So, Communist Party of India, Marxist-Leninist People's War Group is created. एग्जाम में तीन बार फुल फॉर्म लिख दो, 150 सब वहीं खत्म. Now, once the CPI-MLPWG was created, the creation of the PWG number one marks the beginning of the second phase of left-wing extremism. First phase, the leader of the movement is Charu Majumdar. Second phase, it is Satyamurthy right now. The second phase, People's War Group, from the name is number one clear. Party adopts a very militant strategy. The violence and the intensity of the violence increases drastically. The second phase is a phase that basically continues all the way from December 1972 to 2001. So second phase lasts for a long time. It continues almost till 2001. In the second phase, the party brought about certain changes. However, the core ideology remained the same. but only certain operational strategies were changed which were there. And these operational strategies made the organization more militant in nature. So what were these operational strategies that they changed? And what were the other issues that they basically picked up? We will continue from here in the next class. And we'll finish up this topic. Thank you.